Good morning. Welcome to New Hope Church. It's great to have you with us today. Before I get to this stuff, most of us know exactly where we were 15 years and about 4 hours ago. Tell you exactly where I was. Side of my bed, getting ready to put some clothes on, and don't go there visually, all right? And TV on the dresser was on, and the news came on, and I watched that second plane crash into the towers. And I thought, what are we going to do? And that's an important question at every moment of life. What are we going to do? But it's particularly an important question at moments of difficulty, tragedy, and trauma. What are we going to do? And in a matter of probably an hour, I had been on the phone with a couple of my pastor friends, and we made the decision that what we were going to do that day in the city of Clovis, and this hangs in my office, so I'll never forget, that is what we did. We gathered right here. There was no radio announcements, no TV announcements. There was no time for that. Just by word of mouth, as pastors to our congregations, to friends that we ran into that day. There was no program, there was no music, this was no planned service. This was just a time for the community to come together and to begin to pray. And I don't think we should ever stop. I don't think we should ever stop. Our nation is as challenging as I think it's ever been in the history of my lifetime. And these are important days for us to pray. If you pay attention, you'll never forget 911. Every time you walk into the doors of this church, most of you have to walk by a fountain that sits out here. And before the year is over, we're going to have all the names of the boys from the city of Clovis on that fountain. That fountain was originally put in after both Hubbard and Barrow. And it has become a place much like Gilgal was in the Old Testament when the nation of Israel crossed into the land of promise and God said, pick up 12 stones from the riverbed. And when you get on the other side, build an altar so that in the future when you walk by with your children and your grandchildren, you can tell them how God has delivered you. He said, don't forget to remember. And that fountain sits out there as a reminder to us to not forget to remember. You and I have been so blessed, in spite of our challenges and difficulties we may find ourselves in at the moment, we have been blessed to be part of a nation that has so much to offer. And I would love for this nation to continue to have so much to offer to the next generations that are coming. But God has no responsibility to hold us up as a nation if we choose to forsake His ways. And that's where we are at this moment in our history. We no longer, it may say it on our money, but we do not believe it in our hearts. In God we trust. And so those are our challenges today. And so what is it that we need to do? We need to do exactly today what we did then. And that is we need to pray. So let's pray for our nation at the very outset of this morning. Our Father, it has been a privilege for me to be a child of Lonnie and June Rowland. It has been a joy and a delight throughout my life to be their child. It has been my joy and my privilege to have been born in the country called the United States of America, to have had the opportunities of education and life and liberty and freedom. It has been such a joy. And Father, I don't ever want to take either one of those for granted. I'm grateful. I didn't do anything to deserve either one of those blessings. There are children born in abusive families, children born in abusive cultures. They had nothing to do with that either. But Lord, what I'm most grateful for today is that I'm a child of your kingdom, that I had the privilege of hearing the truth about who you are and how much you love me in spite of what I am, and that you can make a difference in my life and through the lives of others that call you Father, you can make a difference in the world. I pray that we will not live in such isolation of each other that the influence of your life in us will be diminished, but we will live in such fellowship with each other that the influence of your truth and your ways will be amplified in the culture that you've placed us in. That you can continue to do great things for, in, and through this nation that we call home. I love you so very much. I thank you for the sacrifices that have been made over the years for this nation, for those who brave an unknown world so they could have the freedom of worship, for those who have fought war after war to preserve what you've been doing here. Not so that we could have a maintenance mentality as a nation, but so that we could, Father, spread your gospel from here literally to the other parts of the world. Lord, I pray for the Hubbards and the Barrows and the Ishans and the Butterfields, and Father, the other families that are connected to the community of Clovis and Fresno who've lost their sons and daughters. It's a sacrifice to this nation. I never want to forget. And I pray that you will use us to be of encouragement as often as is necessary and as is needed to be useful for your work. Thank you. May we never forget both the sacrifice of our own citizens and the sacrifice of your Son. They have made a difference for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thanks for being here today. If you are a guest at New Hope, it's your first time here, we are so honored that you would choose to be with us today. There are guest cards or communication cards in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to fill it out. We don't ask for your social security number, all right, or your checking account number, all right, but we would love to know of your presence here. All we're going to do is through the mail send you information that tells you what goes on around here, what we believe, the kind of ministries that are available. There's a place for you to ask questions. If you have some particular questions, you would love us to answer for you. And we will not knock on your door or harass you on the phone unless you ask for that. Otherwise, we're just going to put this information in your hands through the mail. So we'd love for you to do that. Those cards are there also for our regular church family. If you have messages to the staff or announcements or prayer requests, please use those cards. Get them to us, and we will address them as soon as we possibly can. In the pew, I mentioned it last week, but I'm going to highlight it again this week. There's a small card in there, all right? Barely stands up above the lip, all right? But you can see it. It says Pops Marketplace on it. And those cards are there. It's one of the projects of one of our small groups in our church family. And they're going to be putting out a, lack of a better term, a newsletter, all right? And it will be available on the welcome cart. They will pass it out when it's brand new. It'll also be on the website. But if you have needs or wants or promo things, you can put them on here. If you're a plumber and you're looking for business, put your name on there and say, I'm a plumber, all right? And if you have any plumbing needs, and somebody knows, okay, there's somebody in the church who does plumbing. You say, hey, I'm needing a care provider, okay? You can put that on there. And if somebody provides that kind of care, they can connect with you. Hey, I need a refrigerator, okay? You're young, married and broke, moving in someplace, hey, write it on there. Hey, I got a refrigerator to give away, all right? Put it, am I making sense? All right, just a way of connecting, all right? And so you put that in the offering, they pick it up on Tuesday, and they'll try to keep it current about every 2 to 3 weeks, all right? And so we had like 17 last week, all right, that got turned in. So by next week, it'll be up and going, but we'd love for you to take advantage of that opportunity. Speaking of small groups, before I move on, next Sunday night, right here at the church, Teddy, Corey, where are you? I know Teddy's here. Teddy, stand up. Corey, stand up. All right, those are our small group leaders, our hope group leaders. And what are we, I'm going to, no, wait, 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 wait. I know you just love to stand up. Hey, you should have seen this guy in a suit Friday night. Oh, man, did he look good. No, I'm not through with you yet. Now I know why Christy married him, all right? He wore a suit when they went on dates because he looked really, really good. What are we going to do next Sunday night?
Well, Teddy says eat ice cream.
We're going to eat ice cream. That's right.
That's why we're friends with Teddy. That's always Teddy's answer. What are we going to do? Eat ice cream.
Okay. So it's an ice cream social and a small group lunch.
Yes. So we'll give more information about the church-wide study materials. We'll have the materials there, right, Teddy?
Yes.
And then if there's people who want to join groups, they're welcome to come that night, or I'll be out there today in the pavilion if you want to give me your name and contact information so you can form some groups. And I know I do have a couple of people who had put in cards, and I've just been holding on to them. You've not been forgotten. I've just been holding on to your cards till we get those groups together.
So this event now Sunday night is for already regular small group members. All right, come, encourage others. You come and come eat ice cream, all right? Number three, it's all available for you. If you've never been part of a small group around here, come check out what it's like. You'll hear more information. Coming that night doesn't mean you're signed up. You could still say, nah, I don't want to do that. I will tell you it's the best thing I think you can do to connect in a church family. You'll get a chance to meet people. Hey, if you want to come and change small groups, you want to be in a different group than you're in, not because they're lousy people, but just because you want to meet other people, all right? That's okay to do. I'm going to say this with great kindness and love. It's okay to change groups, just like it's okay to sit in a different place in the sanctuary. Okay, you don't have to sit in the same place. In fact, just so you know, I don't make this stuff up. I just found out this past week, we have a lady who has been attending New Hope for probably 12 years. Okay? She says she is not coming ever again to the 9:15 service. She's only because she was told to move, that she was in somebody's seat. Now, that's not the first time I've told you that story. It happens, all right? And that's not a nice thing, okay? It's not a nice thing, all right? You come in, you get a seat. Yes?
And so you didn't tell me I was going to get to talk, so no.
Okay, yeah, I know. That's, yeah.
So it's an 8-week study, and it's open way if you're committing for the 8 weeks.
Okay, yes. If you just want to try a small group for the 8 weeks while we do this new study.
We have some groups that have been together for 3 years, and that might be scary to some people. So, and we do have people in groups who are willing to take the lead on a new group. We just need some new people.
Okay. Terrific. So show up that night, say, hey, I'd like to be a part of a group, and we have groups that meet different nights during the week, all right? So sometimes it's based on time, sometimes it's location, and so anyway, just show up. Hope groups, they're messy, all right? Figuring all the logistics out, you know, it's never smooth or easy, but it is great, because let me tell you, when the chips are down, you know who the first responders are for you? Small groups, okay? Because sometimes you're afraid to call the pastor, but you're not afraid to call somebody in a small group that you've become friends with now. You know them well enough, and then they call the pastor. And you know what? Sometimes the pastor can't be there for every single one of you, okay? Just don't have enough hours in a day, but your small group can. And so really, really important stuff. You grow and you develop relationships. So that's next Sunday night. Man, Teddy and Corey hope to see you here, all right? So don't miss that. There's a couple things coming up. This is a little invitation. You will see them on the tables as you go out the door. You will find some of these on the welcome cart out there. If you've been here more than 5 years, you know that there was 2 years in a row in there that we did a special Sunday. It was called Make a Difference Sunday. We told you to go and get mad. And it was really a shot in the arm for us the first 2 years we did it. It came as a result of a funeral that I did, and everybody who spoke at this gentleman's memorial service, his name was John, everybody got up and said the last thing John said to me was, go make a difference. His kids said every time that he dropped them off at school, the last words out of his mouth as they got out of the car to head to school is, make a difference in school today. When his soccer team players left the field, he would say, hey, go home and make a difference. And that just resonated with me. And so we got a few folks together, and we planned our first ever Make a Difference Sunday here. And we really worked hard to make the music something extra special that day. And the message was really designed for you to invite friends and family who don't have a relationship with God, but you'd like to introduce God to them. We wanted to introduce our church to them maybe slightly in a different way. It was also a good reminder that we need to make a difference and freshen up things that we do from time to time. And so we haven't done it in about 4 years, and so we are going to do a Make a Difference month, not just a Sunday, all right? And that's what this card is, an invitation to the first Sunday. There are 5 Sundays in October. I don't know if you're aware of this, but 4 months every year has 5 Sundays. Pastors know that. Those are our favorite months of the year, okay? And most of you are thinking, yeah, that's because you get an extra week to preach. No, it's an extra offering to take, all right? It always bails you out of a bad month, okay? That kind of, the fifth Sunday always bails you out. So we're always grateful for that. But we're going to do a 5-week series on Make a Difference. And the first Sunday is the special one. All right, all of them are going to be special, but this is the one really to invite friends or relatives that might not be plugged in anywhere, do not have a relationship with God. We will have just 2 services that day. Listen carefully. 9 a.m. So those of you who come at 9:15, you'll be late, and you'll be sitting over in the high school room because it's for overflow that Sunday for those 2 services. 9 a.m. and 10:45 will be the service times that day. Tim Kepler will be with us, and we do not have an 8 o'clock on that Sunday, so 9 and 10:45, working on the music, going to be really, really good, and we trust the message. And it's called Make a Difference with Your Life. That's the theme of that Sunday. The other 4 Sundays, not necessarily in this order. We're going to look at Make a Difference through your church, Make a Difference in your family, Make a Difference with your community, Make a Difference around the world. And so we're going to look at each of those themes in the month of October. And this is an invitation. Pick a couple up, give them to a family, friend, or a coworker. Be very specific and intentional about inviting somebody to come be with you. That's good preparation for what's going to happen next April of 2017. When Luis Palau comes to town with the City Fest. And you're going to hear more about that next week. But I want you to begin to think about 3 to 5 names that you would like to begin planting the seeds of an invitation to take them to a very special event that I trust will make a lasting difference in the cities of Fresno and Clovis. We're going to launch Make a Difference Month on a Saturday, October the 1st. It's called Backing the Badge Barbecue. Most of you know that last Saturday a week ago, two of our sheriffs were shot at the county jail, and there has been lots of challenges going on with their families, and we are going to throw our efforts in along with others in the communities to be of help and to make a difference. So it's going to start on that Saturday, the very first day of October, from 12 to 3 o'clock. Bite Me Barbecue, along with other men in our church, are going to host a barbecue here on the church grounds. You can bring neighbors, friends. There's no service, no offering taken, but they will take your contributions. All right, it's a $10 barbecue, and there'll be a pot out there if you want to give more. We are attempting to get all of the stuff donated, and if you want to help with just purchasing supplies, put something in the offering that says for the barbecue, and we will use it to get the supplies that are not donated, and that will be from 12 to 3 on October the 1st, okay? And if you have any questions, see Teddy Miller or John Longstaff about that. Did I cover everything on that, Teddy? Okay. Moving right along, because I'm not moving very fast today. Let me highlight a few things. What did I miss? Oh, Tuesday, Primetimers. If you are 55 or older, lunch right over there in that building. If you've never been, just show up. If you've been before, you know what to bring. May I suggest to you more main dishes this month, less desserts. You were a little one-sided, I understand, last week. All right, and you guys always have a great time, and you've got a special guest speaker from the Pregnancy Care Center. I find that so hilarious. Our seniors are having a visit from the Pregnancy Care Center. What have you been up to? I think it's great. You're going to enjoy this presentation, though. It's a great presentation. Widow's Lunch Bunch will be meeting next Sunday after the last service, and the information is in the bulletin if you need that. Hey, if you want to go on the camp out, you might be too late, all right? Contact Mark, and he'll tell you if there's any room left, all right? Those spots went very, very quickly. Friday night, we had a great time at the Heinz Hospice 35th gala event, celebrating 35 years of Heinz Hospice, caring for the needs of families in the Central Valley. Amy, stand up. I don't know if everybody knows who Amy is. Amy is the CEO now of Nancy Heinz. We did not get much taller when we hired Nancy over, Amy after Nancy, all right? And we are so blessed. We are so blessed to have her part of our church fellowship, and so thank you so much for what you're doing, continuing the legacy and the care of what Heinz Hospice is all about. It was a great evening. It moved very fast. Our table was full, and we had others who sat at other tables from New Hope who were there. Here's the deal. I committed y'all to $2,500, okay? During the fundraising time of that. So, if over the next 3 weeks you would like, all right, otherwise Shelly has to write the check for the whole $2,500, all right? New Hope has been so blessed by the ministry of Heinz Hospice over the years. First off, your pastor was blessed by being a chaplain for 8 or 9 years. And I learned so many things. So many of my stories come out of my days with Heinz Hospice. I had the privilege of serving on their board for 3 years. And many of you have been ministered to by Heinz Hospice in difficult moments. And what I want you to understand is the reason you guys have often thanked me for helping you make that step to Heinz Hospice, here's what I want you to know. It was primarily because of Nancy and Amy and Jane. Because I have cell phone numbers for all three of them, and I have used them on occasions when sometimes we needed something a little bit faster, and they have never, ever failed to respond to that. And so we have been very blessed, particularly as a church here. And so if you would like to help me raise that $2,500, and you know what? Here's the deal. If we raise more than $2,500, we'll give it to them. Okay? So don't feel bad, but I think you can do that. So if in an offering over the next week or two you'd like to put something in, write a check to New Hope Church, put on the envelope, Heinz Hospice, then at the end of the month we'll see that that check gets delivered to them. All right? Thank you so very much. Some prayer requests. Marguerite, which is Richard Brown's mom, has had surgery again. This is her second surgery in just a matter of months, so please remember to pray for her. Lawrence, we don't need to pray for him anymore. He's sitting back there looking good, man. That's a praise item now. He's got a pacemaker. Where'd they take you when you climbed stairs this week? I don't know. Milo told me they took you somewhere and you climbed stairs. Not yet. All right. Well, Milo, you lied. All right. Anyway, he's looking good, and we're grateful for that. Eddie Sisko is a teenage son of a family in our church, and he was at a neighborhood party, and there was a drive-by shooting, and he got shot in the leg, and it fractured his femur. They said an inch either other direction, they probably could not have saved his life. So if you have to be grateful for getting shot, it's good to get shot in the right place. And he is recovering, so continue to pray for him. Judge Jim Aaron, we mentioned him last week. He had an embolism last Sunday morning. They got him in surgery. We got the message after the third service that he did not make it through the service and through the surgery. And his service is this afternoon at Trinity Church. So please be praying for the Aaron family today. Jerry Brown, not the governor. But this other, that Jerry Brown always needs our prayers. This Jerry Brown sometimes needs our prayers. And it's this week he's going in for some more testing on his heart. Things are not kind of going the way he feels like they should. So they're doing some testing on him this week. So please be praying for him. And one last praise report, and that is Brandy Walker, who 8 or 9 months ago we were praying for because we thought she would lose her eye because of the tumor. And the only way to take care of it, they thought here, was to remove the eye, remove the tumor, and do chemo. She got in touch with a specialist in Boston. She made a few trips back. They did treatment there. Her eye has been saved. The tumor is gone. So that is a praise item. Okay. They are not using the term cancer-free, okay, but she is tumor-free right now. And so she will continue to do follow-ups for another couple of years there, but we are grateful for this step in that situation. So I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering, and would you bow with me as we pray? Our Father, I want to thank you for the life that you share with us. Thank you for the privilege that we have of worship this morning. May our May our ears and our hearts be attentive to what it is that you want to say to us personally. Father, it's one thing for me to say something to everybody, but it's quite another thing for you to say something through your word to us personally. May we listen, and more importantly, may we follow. Father, we trust you with the needs that we've shared. We thank you for the items of praise that we've expressed, and we thank you for the privilege of giving. We trust you for all this in the name of Christ. Amen. I think I saw the Christiansens come in during opening number. Would you stand up, please? Amanda and Cameron, and the most beautiful one in their family. All right, guys, here's the deal. They have 7 days left, and they're leaving the Central Valley of California, and they are heading to Oregon, all right, to start a new life there. So this is the last service they will be with us, all right, is today. And after the next service, there's a little gathering out in the pavilion if you want to go by and say goodbye. All right, they're going to be out in the pavilion, and then maybe if the high school group gets out of the way, we'll move in where it's cooler into there. But just a chance for you to say goodbye. If you've got a card you want to give to them just to say farewell, you can do that. But it's just to really put your arm around them and shake their hand and tell them how much you've loved having them here. Amanda's grown up in this church since she was an itty-bitty girl. And now she has an itty-bitty girl, all right? And since she brought that handsome guy in with her, all right, when they got married, and we're so excited. I got to tell you, he's more handsome today than the first time she introduced him to me, all right? Yeah, but it's terrific. We love having you here. You're always part of New Hope, all right? Always part of New Hope. So thank you, and we'll see you later, all right? If you'd like to find Psalm 126, I just tore a page out of my Bible. Just did. That's what tape is for. That was Psalm 119. All right. There's a lot of verses there, so we don't need that one. Just kidding. Well, I think this might mean you're not to take from the Word of God. All right. So we'll tape that one in. But Psalm 126, we'll be reading from in a few moments. I'm going to do something that's a little dangerous. We survived the 8 o'clock service, so we're going to try it again in this service. I have a question for you, and this is not a rhetorical question today, okay? I'm actually going to allow some of you to share an answer, all right? May not have time for everybody who volunteers, but I do want to hear from a few of you on this question. So here it is. Have you ever experienced something in your life that was like a dream come true? Is there a moment that you can reflect back upon, and at that moment you thought, am I dreaming? This is everything I've dreamed for. So I want you to think about that for just a moment or two. If you have to think about it too long, you probably don't have one of those moments. Okay? You probably, all right, Fawn.
The day I married Tim.
Oh my God, I knew somebody would do that. The day you married Tim. What do you want? Oh, okay, all right, you got him. All right, all right. We had that in the 8 o'clock service too, the day you got married, besides that one. Yes, stand up, stand up. Use your outside voice.
Oh, when I found my birth family.
When you found your birth family, okay, all right. And who all in that family did you find?
I found my mother, my brothers, and my sister.
Okay, and how old were you when that happened?
I was 36 or so.
Okay, so just about 5 years ago.
Yeah.
Okay, all right, all right.
What do you want?
Okay. I'm getting you out of trouble. I'm getting... Mike.
Well, my wife got back next.
When you guys got baptized here. All right, yeah, that was a great day. That was a great day.
When I was doing time, incarcerated inmate, and I received a letter from this woman right here that I married back in 1985. She accepted me back. That was the most incredible day of my life.
Okay, Let me hold your applause just a second, because let me set this up for you a little bit better, all right? Because it's tough to tell that story. All right, you got married what year?
1985.
What year did you go into prison?
2008.
Okay, how long had you been separated when you went into prison?
22 years.
Okay, and you had been in prison in that same period of time? You were also incarcerated?
No, yeah.
Before? Yeah, during the 22 years. Part of the reason for their separation is both of them were in prison. Okay? And I remember you having a conversation with some other ladies, my sister being one of them, and you weren't sure if you were still married. Okay? Because so she then had found Jesus. You had found Jesus in prison. She sent him a letter testing the waters. Are we still married? And man, the rest is history. And you've been out of prison how long now?
21 years.
21 years, okay. And you have been out now?
Since 2011.
All right. We got to see him his first Sunday, all right? First Sunday right here, so for the last 5 years. So awesome. That's a dream come true moment, no question, all right? Anybody else? Yes.
When the first love of my life came back into my life after 60 years of separation, and I got to know his son, and I got to know another family.
Yeah, another 10 years. Yeah, after 60 years, all right, finds her sweetheart again. And all right, somebody back here, yes. Amanda, since you're leaving us, I got a call on you.
Well, having her was one of the greatest, but also finding out that we were pregnant with her because we've been trying for several years.
Yeah, right, some difficulties in your pregnancy and finding out, all right, that it's good to go. All right, terrific. Yeah, I always want to call you Hope, Kelly, because I know. Kelly Hope Perlstein, I all the time want to call her Hope.
Well, besides marrying him, honestly, Teddy married us, and when he said we're man and wife, I just started laughing hysterically because I was so happy. But, and I'm crying, sorry. But becoming a teacher, I have a lot of obstacles, and it's all I ever wanted to do. And when I finally became a high school teacher, I was deliriously happy.
School teacher.
26 years later, I don't know if I'm that deliriously happy.
All right. You know, there are organizations in this country that try to make dreams come true. There's one organization called Dreams Come True. Check it out on Google if you've never been there. It's quite an impressive story in history behind that organization. Most of us in this room are probably familiar with Make-A-Wish Foundation. And these are organizations that come along alongside of people who are going through really difficult times. Usually, end of life is not too far down the road, and they're wanting to do something to make those last days memorable and maybe even better for them. Our dream come true moments can go from trite to sublime, but they're still dream moments. 8 o'clock service, I remember the ones that Chad was there with Bo. This is a trite side of things, all right? It was Chad's first year playing junior college baseball. Reedley, JC, they were playing Fresno City College. Fresno City College just treats Reedley, JC awful. They beat them almost every time they play them. And we were facing their best pitcher, kid from Central called De La O, and this guy was really, really good. We're losing, I think it's 6-2, and Chad's the first one up in the inning, and he strikes out. The rest of that inning, though, goes pretty good, all right? We end up, it's 6-4, all right? And two runners on base, and Chad comes up again in the same inning, two outs, two runners on base. We're down two runs, and the dad's agonizing, all right? I'm there. He can't strike out twice in the same inning, okay? And I have rarely ever prayed at sporting events. Okay, I don't. I'm not sure how much God gave. He cares about how we act. Okay, not necessarily about whether we win or lose the game. So I rarely pray at sporting events. That is one day I prayed. And my prayer really was not for a home run. My prayer was don't strike out. Okay? You know, make contact. Chad hit a home run with the go-ahead run, all right? Puts us up 7-6. That was a dream come true moment, all right? Only home run he hit that year. Only home run he hit that year. And it was right there. Maybe I should have prayed more. But I got to be honest, that was a trite event. But yet, it was a dream come true moment. I got to tell you, some of my other dream come trues besides, family, really have come as a result of my connection with Heinz Hospice. Most of you have heard the story of Caroline Timpkin, and I'm not going to tell that whole story again, but my first hospice patient was a 19-year-old girl from Kansas out here going to Fresno State, diagnosed 4 months after she arrived with acute leukemia and beyond any stage of treatment. We spent the next 2 months. Her mom flew out. I spent almost time every single day over the next 2 months at that apartment. The boys went with me. They were small, and Caroline loved little kids. Mom was able to come to church several of those Sundays. Our church family got engaged. I actually drove back and did her funeral. And the dream moment was the first time I saw her, she and I shared with each other that this was a moment that was bigger than the two of us. God had something in mind more than just caring for her for these 8 weeks. And that dream moment came on a hillside out of a little town of less than 800 people in a cemetery on a cold November day. And the closing prayer was the pastor who lived there, and I introduced him and I said, if when he says amen, any of you who want to discover the Jesus that Caroline enjoyed her last 6 weeks of life, then meet me underneath that oak tree and I'll stay as long as it takes and we'll pray and you can receive Christ. And so while he prayed, I walked over to that oak tree and I bowed my head. And when he said amen and I lifted my eyes, I had a row of about 20 people standing single file. And at the end of that row were two women who the previous year, each of them had lost their daughters. And they said, for a year, we had no idea if we could make it to the next year. You've given us answers out of God's word that have healed our hearts today. And it was like a dream come true. And I wished I knew what that was, something that God said. And that was special. The other one was an Alma Goodman story. Alma weighed 660 pounds. One of the largest people I've ever seen in my life. She had told the nurse that she did not want a chaplain to come because God hated her. And as a result, she hated God. And one day, I get a call from the same nurse, and she said, Tim, could you come right now? Alma has said yes to seeing a chaplain, and she might change her mind. Would you come right now? I stopped what I was doing. I ran across town, praying all the way, wondering, God, what am I going to say to this woman who hates you? And I didn't know when I walked through the door. I'd already been told that when she passes, they would have to take the window out of her bedroom in order to, because no way to get through the doorways. She had to lay flat because of breathing. And I walked into a room, still uncertain what I was going to say. And I got to be honest, I was a bit shocked when I looked down at her and I said the thing I said to her. I had to look right down over her face like this. And I looked down and I said, Alma, who do you think you are? And her eyes got big, and she said, what do you mean? And I said, I want to know who you think you are, that God hates you. And she said, well, I'm just the worst. This is her words, I'm the worst sinner. I said, really? I said, have you killed Christians? Oh, Tim, I haven't killed anybody. I said, Paul did. I said, did you crucify people? Oh, no. I said, Paul did. I said, did you find delight in stoning people? Oh, I don't know what Paul did. I said, so you're not the worst sinner? I said, no, and God loved Paul and saved him. He wrote, and I hold up my Bible, and I said, he wrote half this New Testament. And I've never seen anybody cry this way. See, she couldn't raise her head, so the tears couldn't go down her cheeks. They went off the side of her eyes, and she just started weeping. She said, God does love me. And she prayed. I didn't even have to lead her in a prayer. She just started praying. And that was a dream come true moment. And I got to tell her daughter, as I walked out, her daughter said, what'd you do to my mom? I said, you know, I didn't do anything, but God did a whole lot. I said, God has forgiven her of her sins. He's come to live within her life, and he's going to take her home to heaven. And don't be surprised if it happens today. I said, I have no scientific evidence. I am not the doctor. I'm not the nurse. I said, all I can tell you is what I've seen happen and lots of other experiences with patients like your mom when I've been there and they've prayed to receive Christ. I said, this body, when all it knows is this life, it holds on as tightly as it can to every breath. It struggles to stay alive. But as soon as there is peace in the heart and you know there is eternal life and something better when you leave this world, I said, they're free. So I said, I can't tell you, but don't be surprised. All I'm telling you is don't be surprised. 5.5 hours later, the daughter calls and said, Mom's in heaven. Oh, dream come true moment. And we have those. And Psalm 126 was written by a writer who had a dream come true moment. Let's read it. As I read it, I want you to understand the way it kind of breaks down, and maybe it'll make even more sense than it will just by reading it. The first two verses are the narrative. It's the short story explanation, all right? The next verse is a song as a result of the story. Okay? Sometimes neat things happen and we break out in song. The next verse is a prayer. As a result of breaking, that's kind of like church. We sing and then we pray. All right? That's what they do. And then the last one is a promise that has results. So let's read it. When the Lord brought back the captives of Zion, Israel had been in captivity for 70 years. The nation of Israel had been enslaved. Jerusalem had been destroyed. And they had been in captivity for 70 years. And now they're returned. And by the way, they weren't in captivity 70 years because the king wanted to necessarily keep them that long. He was tired of feeding them. He would have been happy to have sent them back. But do you know why they stayed quite so long? Because they didn't want to go back. Who's going to rebuild their city? See, they didn't want to, freedom wasn't worth the effort to rebuild their town. It was only when God sent a prophet to them who then said, hey, I'm going to take you back and we're going to rebuild what the enemy destroyed. They got inspired and then God set them free. And notice their response. We were like men who dreamed. Our mouths were filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy. Then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like streams in the valley, in the Negev, all right, in the valley. Those who sow in tears will reap with songs of joy. And he or she who goes out reaping, carrying seed to sow, will return with songs of joy, carrying sheaves with him. Let me pause before I go on. Do you have any idea what a sheave is? Do you have any idea what a sheave is? Okay, so it doesn't make sense, does it? All right, we're approaching Halloween and Thanksgiving. Have you ever seen stalks of corn tied in bundles? That's a sheave. Okay? Now does it make sense? Sometimes we got to get current, all right, because things are old. This was written thousands of years ago. But they would go harvest, they would stack bundles up, they would wrap them, leave them right there, continue the harvest, and then when they finished the field, go back and gather as many bundles as they could and then take them to the storage area, all right, where they could process them. And so he's simply saying here, hey, if you sow enough seed, there's going to be a harvest, and you'll get to carry the results of the harvest, the benefit of sowing seed, you'll get to carry back with you. Psalm 26 is the story of hope when it appeared that hope was gone. Deliverance and freedom seemed like a dream. But when God is involved in our lives, dreams can become realities. If we took the time today, we could go to Genesis 28 and investigate the dream that Jacob had where he saw the ladder ascending and descending from heaven to earth. And it's at that moment that he wrestled with God, and God changed his name from Jacob to Israel. And Israel was the father of a dozen kids who became the heads of the tribes of Israel as a nation. And then his son, Joseph, like father, like son, Joseph had a dream that he was going to be in great leadership and rescue his family. And years later, that dream came true. It's like another Joseph found in the New Testament, Matthew chapter 1, who was about ready to quietly put away his fiancée because she was pregnant. And God appeared to him in a dream and said, "This pregnancy comes from me. I'm asking you to be my son's earthly father. Don't put Mary away. Take her into your home and take my son and raise him as yours." Verses 1 and 2 is the narrative. Notice it opens up with, God did great things. God loves to do great things. And please notice in this passage who noticed that God did great things. Can you tell me who noticed that God did great things? Yeah, the nations. The very people who had held Israel captive noticed that God did something great for Israel. The other nations around who would like to have taken Israel captive, the descendants of Ishmael, who all of them hated Israel, they noticed that God did great things for Israel. Reminds me of a couple of songs that have been written from this one song. Songs I grew up singing in church. Some of you remember this one. He has done great things. Great things, great things. He has done great things for me. I'm going to be a witness, a witness, a witness for Him. I'm going to let my light shine, shine, shine. I'm going to let my light shine because He has done great things for me. And then one more recent one that we sing, I will bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless His holy name. Why? For He has done great things. This is the psalm that song comes from. The Lord does great things for His people, and these things that God does commands the attention of the world, and they inspire the devotion of His saints. Notice the song in verse 3. The awe of the world, and I use this term in the 8 o'clock service, and forgive me for using it, because this is a word that sometimes becomes offensive, and I don't mean it to be, but I think sometimes we get a little too cautious and try not to be offensive, that sometimes we don't draw this line that we understand the difference between believing and not believing in God. Other places, this passage where it talks about other nations saw the great things of God, it's the same term that is translated the heathen. And I've shared with people over the years, and they said, "Pastor Tim, I just got to tell you, I'm a heathen." We don't hear that a whole lot anymore. And what they mean by that is, I have nothing to do with God. That's the nations that noticed that God did great things. They saw it, they noticed it, they commented about it, and the awe of the world caught the attention of these people who were laughing about being free now. It caught their attention. And so they began to sing about the awe-inspiring things of God. Oh, if it were not the other way around, if the awe of God's children would inspire the world to sing of the wonders of God, how great that would be. You see, deliverance is exhilarating. When you've been delivered from prison, it's exhilarating. When you've been delivered from an addiction, it's exhilarating. When you've been delivered out of a financial bondage, it is liberating to the ones delivered, and it's liberating to those who've noticed the deliverance. You see, joy is the natural outflow of the Christian life. It's not generated by us. It's because God does it. Did they get delivered out of captivity because of what they did? No, they were content to stay there. But because God did it, joy showed up. We don't need a distraction from stress in our lives. What we need is a cure. And the cure is Jesus Christ. Number four is the prayer. Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like streams in the desert. In other words, God, restore us, revive us, refresh us. And God's good at doing all of those things. Then the promise, verses 5 and 6. I want you to notice the sequence and the consequence. Those who sow in tears will reap with songs of joy. So what's the sequence? What do you do first? You sow and then reap. That's the sequence. You never can reverse the sequence. Okay? You got to sow first and then you reap. I think there's a lot of folks who like to think that all we have to do is reap. Just, you know, we kind of have, I think even in church, we have this entitlement mentality that if we build it, they will come. No. We have to go and spread the seed. And God then produces a harvest because we've gone and spread the seed, and then we get to bring them back, carrying the sheaves with us. So that's the sequence, but it's also the consequence. If we sow, we reap. If we don't sow, we don't reap. Okay? Logical, pretty simple. Gratitude for a dream come true leads to sowing and sharing with the right attitude. And the right attitude is with tears. Tears of joy because we have been delivered. Tears of joy because we've been redeemed. Tears of joy because we have been restored. Tears of joy because we have been revived. And also, tears of brokenness. Tears of brokenness for our family who have not yet been redeemed. Tears of brokenness for friends who have not yet been revived. Tears of brokenness for those we see whose lives are broken and we've not yet done one thing to give them freedom and deliverance. Without sowing, there is no reaping. But when there is sowing, there will be singing when the reaping comes. We might be crying while we're sowing, but we will be singing when we're reaping. You and I are to go out and carry the seed that we have in our hearts. We are to water it with our tears. And God says, I'll promise you this, you will return with joy and a song. That reminds me of another song. Half of you will know this song. Fawn. Because I don't see Milo. Okay. I know you knew this song. We might sing it. We might sing the chorus in just a minute, so be ready. Get your voice loosened up, all right? We might do the chorus. Okay? Here's the words of the verses. Sowing in the morning, sowing seeds of kindness, sowing in the noontime and the dewy eve, waiting for the harvest and the time of reaping, we shall come rejoicing. Doing what? Bringing in the sheaves. You know, let's sing the chorus. Come on, stand up, lead us. Stand up, lead us. If the pianist was in here, we'd have him play for us, but he's not, okay? So it's bringing in the sheaves, we shall come rejoicing, bringing in, those of you know what, help Fawn out or she'll be singing it solo. Okay. I'll sing with you. Bringing in the sheaves, we shall come rejoicing. Bringing in the sheaves. Once more. Bringing in the sheaves. Bringing in the sheaves. We shall come rejoicing. Bringing in the sheaves. Good job. All of you are in the Christmas choir. And the last verse of the song goes like this, going forth with reaping, sowing for the master. Though the loss is stained, our spirit often grieves. When our weeping's over, he will bid us welcome, and we shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing family and friends on the tailcoats of our faith. Why? Because we planted seeds. We planted seeds. Reap what you sow. What we plant will come back to us. We become what we practice. Galatians 6 says, do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. reap how you sow. The measure of our substance of our planting will be the measure or the substance of our reaping. I heard of a story of a missionary in Africa who received a knock at his door at his hut. He answered the door and the missionary found a native boy holding a large fish in his hand. And the boy said, "Reverend, you taught us about tithing, so here's my tithe. I've brought it to you." The missionary gratefully took the fish and then he asked the boy a question. He said, "If this is your tithe, where are the other 9 fish?" As the boy beamed, he said, "Oh, they're still in the river. I'm going back to catch them now." I like that boy. I like that boy. He understood, hey, I'm going to bring with joy. I'm going to bring the first fish, the first fruits. God will provide the rest. 1 Corinthians 15 says, "How foolish, what you sow does not come to life until it dies." Till you plant a seed and it dies, it does not give life. 1 Corinthians 9 says, remember this, whoever sows sparingly reaps sparingly, and whoever sows generously reaps generously. And remember, we will reap later than we sow. We do not reap before it's time. Martha Berry was a lady with a vision to help children. She began a school for poor children. She had no books, no building, no money. But she heard, she had a dream. And she went to Henry Ford and she asked Henry Ford, the founder of the Ford automobile, she asked for a donation. Mr. Ford reached into his pocket and he gave Martha Berry a dime. Most people would have been insulted. Here's a multimillionaire and all he could give was a dime. But Martha took the dime. She went to the store. She bought a packet of seeds. She planted a garden in her backyard. She raised a crop. She sold it. She bought more seeds. She did this 4 times. She had 4 harvests. And at the end of the 4th harvest, she had enough money to buy an old building to teach school to these children. She then returned to Mr. Ford and she said, "Sir, look what I did with your dime." And Ford was so impressed, he gave her $1 million for her school. We never know the speed of our seed. We never know how fast it's going to turn into a harvest. Robert Louis and Stevenson said, "Don't judge each day by the harvest you reap, but by the seeds that you plant." Have you planted any seeds lately? Let me wrap up with a story. Because of yesterday, I really like singing that song, "Bringing in the Sheaves." Because I'm carrying a sheave into church today. I had a funeral, a memorial service in Bakersfield yesterday. Yesterday, Bakersfield felt like the next door neighbor to hell. It was 90 degrees at 10:15 in the morning. This was a backyard event. It's for Rick and Patty Lewis. They're here. It was for Rick's mom. Rick's mom died 2 weeks ago. And the service was yesterday. And we started about 10:30, and it was hot, like some of you are doing now. Turn the coolers down, guys. And it was hot. It was a little sticky. There's a smoker on the patio that's puffing smoke out of really good smells. Another guy brought in a couple of big foil tin things of deep pit barbecue beef, and that this odor is just going through that whole backyard. We shared about Mary's life, told her story. What a wonderful lady, smart. Love Jesus, know exactly where she is. And I planted seed. It's like I've done at hundreds of other memorial services before. Pretty straightforward, kind, loving, I hope, but planting seeds. You don't always see the day of a memorial service any response. You know, some of you are here in church because of a memorial service. That's where why you showed up here later. But when I closed in prayer, it was a granddaughter, great-granddaughter of Mary, Rick and Patty's granddaughter. Just visited with her before we started. She's 19 or 18? 18 years old, just had her physical to join the Air Force. Probably be sent off the first of the year. And while I prayed, she had come down the center between the tables and she was just 2 steps from me. And when I said amen, she took those last 2 steps and she said, "I want to find God." And I said, "Well, he's everywhere to be found." And she said, "No, I mean right now." I said, "You mean here?" I kind of tried to talk her out of it. And she said, "Yeah." She said, "Tim, I've been thinking about this for a couple of months. I want to do it right now." And I said, "Here's the deal." I said, "He's here and he's ready, but I want to make sure you are." And I said, "You realize in this prayer, you got to tell him I'm a sinner. I said that because if you don't do that, then you're not turning to him for the right reason. You just want to feel good. You don't want to be afraid of something. You got to admit we are what we are. She said, I'm ready for that. And I said, okay. You got to invite him to come in and be Lord of your life. It's not just so he'll give you a home in heaven when you die and you can see your great-grandma again. I mean, from now until the day you die, you're going to want to follow his lead and his leadership. He's the Lord of your life. Are you ready to pray that kind? She said, I am. And I mean, she was determined. And I said, let's pray. And right there in the backyard under an awning, this 18-year-old girl. And people said, People will tell us that the message of the gospel doesn't connect to teenagers and young adults anymore. Prove them wrong. Prove them wrong that the gospel does make a difference, that Jesus is real and he's real in you, and you will let him make a difference every day that you live. None of us have great significance on our own, but with Christ in us, great significance can happen through our lives. And today, you know what? It's not because I preached a sermon yesterday that 18-year-old gave her life to Jesus. Do you know why? It's because seeds have been planted throughout her life. Her grandparents brought her to Sunday school when she was little, and she heard from Sunday school teachers every now and then. I believe you brought her to VBS too when you taught VBS, and there were others in our church who planted seeds in her life during a vacation Bible school lesson. And so little by little, seeds were planted. And nobody had to drag her. Nobody tapped her on the shoulder. I mean, this young lady, she walked all on her own right up front. Couldn't wait for amen so she could invite Jesus in her life. That's what Jesus wants to do with your kids and your siblings and your parents who don't know Christ. Are you dropping any seeds into their life? When you get together at family gatherings, are you just talking about the job and the grandkids and the last vacation and the last trip and the last movie? Or do you ever say anything about the value of Jesus Christ in their life? Because when you bury them in the ground, it is not how good the vacation was, and it's not how wonderful their career was or how successful they were in business. It's going to make one bit of difference to you that moment. It is going to be, are they going to be in heaven with you? Do we ever spend the time to drive? And did I say just now? I'm sorry. It's Jerry Molinari's fault, okay? But we gotta plant the seeds, or they'll never grow. With no planting, there is no harvest. And so are we planting? Let's pray. God, forgive me for saying I'm gonna think that you inspired it at that moment. God, I don't preach because I want people to pat me on the back and say that was a fine, nice talk you gave today. God, somebody said 100 years ago or more that the purpose of preaching is to comfort the afflicted and to afflict the comfortable. And God, I pray that happened today. If there are those who showed up today and they are hurting, I trust that through music and prayer and the message, some part of this message, they found your comfort. But for those of us, Father, who've walked in faith with you for too long, but we walk this tightrope between trying to be PC and acceptable to others, we have not made you known to them. Father, I do not want to face eternity knowing that with every fiber of my being, I did not let you express yourself through me in a way that would make a lasting difference in people's lives. We live 60, 70, 80, maybe 90 years on the face of this earth, and then we die. And Father, the only options are hell or heaven, and quite frankly, Father, that's not an option. You have given to us, you have blessed us with the truth of your word, and how often do we share it? I pray that we will walk out of here today farmers. We will walk out of here scattering precious seed. In Jesus' name, Amen.